It's Wednesday, March 11th, 2015, and I'm calling the Board of the Public Works Advisory Commission meeting to order. And the first order of business, I think, is public comment.
And I believe the first order of business for that is to all stand up and applaud the fine Secretary Colleen.
Wow. Okay.
Terry, before we go any further, I wanted to personally thank you and the department wants to thank you for all your work you've done here. I've had a plaque made up for you. It says, Northampton Department of Public Works, we express our sincere appreciation to Terry Culhane and grateful recognition of your 19 years of outstanding and dedicated service to the city of Northampton.
Wow.
Very nice.
I have a public comment here from Jim Dostal as well, who couldn't be with us tonight.
I hope he's in Florida.
It's written in a lot of caps, so I'll speak loudly. It says, unfortunately, he is in Florida, as you mentioned, unable to attend Wednesday's meeting. The loss of Terry's leadership of the Board of Public Works is a devastating blow to the DPW. Terry had a way of gaining consensus that made everyone want to join in and solve the problem. I enjoyed my many years of working with him. I wish him success in whatever he may choose to do. He's earned a chance to sit back, put up his feet, and look over his years of service before he decides to move on. Terry, good luck in whatever you do. Jim Dostal.
Let me suggest that I would like to hear from Chairman Culhane what he considers a couple of his greatest accomplishments during his tenure as chair. Not the whole 19 years.
You know, I have to say, I had a great time. I really enjoyed that part of it. I enjoyed the people that we worked with in the department. I thought the board got tremendous support from the staff, the engineering staff, from the administrative staff, from the directors. I always thought our job was kind of the fun part of it. I guess if I had to pick what I think of as the big accomplishments, the stormwater fee, you'd have to say that. And of course, private ways. It goes without saying. And I hope that the city and the administration and the city council learn more and more about what we do. It's kind of interesting, every time you go to the city council, it would open up a whole box of questions. And I always thought that was terrific, but you know, that you could see them like engage in ways that they don't normally when they're just looking at budget numbers or. So you mean the water goes downhill? You know, you kind of get into some good discussions. So, but I have to say that's the big takeaway is I had a great time. I thought it was kind of fun to do this. We had real work to do, and it was engaging, and it was satisfying. That's all I've got.
You gotta cut the cake.
And I may have, there's more.
To see the trumpet on the top, wait a minute. Do you see the trumpet on the top of that tissue paper? That
was I love it.
It's carefully folded so that the trumpet would be on the top for you.
Oh, man, I missed that.
Thanks to DJ. So be careful with the trumpet.
You know, I said to them that when Bob Maher left, he left because he wanted to play trumpet in the Florence Community Band. And actually, my wife plays in it, and I'm taking trumpet lessons. I'd like to play trumpet, too. So this is the second chair you've lost to the trumpet.
You lost
the
engineer to the trumpet, too.
All right. I remember these. No water, no beer. The American Water Works Association. Thank you, Joe. Yeah, it looks like it's a set. Well, I'll use these.
One for water and one for beer?
He's got one for coffee in there, which he only gets the beer one because he's leaving. If he was still only on the board, he could only
Oh, is
the
there, is this, oh, I should have opened this. So this is different.
Public Works.
This is not a set. It's a morning and an evening set. Not water, not coffee.
Those are the ones we use now. We don't use the beer ones anymore.
Well, that's with the new commission. Back in the old days.
You do it. Florence Steiner, the back room. When I was doing this work,
After the meeting, John Richards,
back room.
He thought that John thought that was the best part of the meeting.
He was right.
Thank you again.
Sweet, huh?
It is. That is slick. Jim's a former trumpet player, and so he knows.
Terry, I just want to point out that you're running behind schedule here.
Do we have a, we have cutlery.
Yeah. Oh, it's going to be too big.
Count the number of people you have to serve here. Get your coat back.
Yeah, so you know, you're always, Dick, you've always got the some good points to make, and I appreciate that. Me. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
15.
15.
15. So that's 1, 2 for you.
Cut them thin.
There's 8 and 16.
That's another thing the city council doesn't know how to do.
Cut the cake.
Cut the cake.
All right. George, it's good to see you here. And you, Dave.
It's good. Thank you. It's good to be here.
And while you're cutting the cake, I just want to express my appreciation, Terry, for so many years of service.
Well, you know, you showed me the way. I liked the way you stepped back. Just that you announced it was the time.
I say we lost a couple of BPW chairs to the trumpet, I guess. But in my case, we lost it for an upgrade. Someone who's done a terrific job. Really appreciate all you've done, ushering in the stormwater fee. And my experience, I don't know how you feel, Bob, but sitting in that chair, I wasn't there as long as you two were, but there's so many times we would have public here, and there's a lot of complicated issues that they would bring up. And Terry was so good at figuring things out. And I remember so many times sitting there and thinking, oh my gosh, what is this person talking about? And all I had to do is turn to Terry, and he'd whisper something. It was usually right on, and it was just so nice to have you on board, and I'm sure they're going to miss you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This looks the organized crew might send the forks with the
cake. This is the cake.
There you go. There we go. We're getting ahead of it now.
Oh, I don't really care. I can go back and alternate.
I don't think so.
Oh, what about beverage? Beverage? Cider, anyone?
There's no almonds on the cake. Almonds on the cake?
I don't know what's on it. It's carrot cake.
We got this down.
That's not me.
Cider behind you?
I'm saying when I bought it, it was.
Sometimes they
really?
Walnuts.
I think we're good.
Sure. I mean, I can do it.
Dave, are you on board? You on board? No?
I'm on board.
You are?
Yes.
Not yet.
Cider?
Go for it.
Cider?
right now.
Wow, all right. Later?
Yes, please.
All right, pass it down. Well, guest of honor, maybe. Grow?
Yep.
You said no one said.
I'd like some.
We always listen to you. Did everybody?
I don't want to, thank you.
Wow, it's great.
Is it hard, Tiger?
Not yet.
Everyone, we get, there are napkins here too, so I guess.
Did you? You're all set. So this is mine.
And some, and then you can pass them.
This cake's got some body to it.
Got a lot of flavor. I'm gonna actually get a thing. Carry on.
Gary, the raisin.
Oh, the raisin.
I thought he'd never leave.
This is very good.
Bro's still cleaning up after Jerry.
He hasn't done public comment.
No, we've been interrupted.
Oh,
continuously.
That's right, okay, good.
He did do it.
This might be public comment.
That's true.
Public comment.
But we only allow 3 minutes.
Do you want some?
Yeah, that's great.
Three times six.
I know, I hate sticky. Oh, you ask my family, I don't like sticky.
You only just got married.
Occasionally gets a bit stressful.
No, I actually have a question.
So Bob's cleaning down public comment.
As far as out of way.
Yeah.
Is there any further public comments?
On any other topics?
I have one, but I don't know if I can top what everybody else has said about it.
Sure.
Over the years, Terry Cohen, as chairman of the DPW, has accepted the task, or voluntarily or otherwise, of being the spokesman or point man at many number of controversial public meetings regarding the city's decision to take actions which were not in every citizen's interest. In closing the landfill, private ways, and stormwater runoff, and many more, Terry's been in the heat of it. He's conducted these meetings with a sense of professionalism, forthrightfulness, and diplomacy that would be difficult for anyone else to match. With his departure, the Department of Public Works and the citizens of Northampton are losing a valuable public servant. Although I've not always agreed with the policies which Terry Cohen has presented to the public, I respect and applaud him for the way he conducted himself and be sorry to see him depart.
Thank you. Yeah. I've always, there's more.
There's
go ahead.
More.
Go ahead.
Over the past few years, I've seen that Terry, as well as other veterans of the Board of Public Works, spent an excessive amount of their time and effort to serve the citizens of the city of Northampton. In return, the city leadership has rewarded these efforts and sacrifices by dissolving the Board of Public Works and creating a commission with no defined purpose or list of duties. The remaining individuals around this table have been given a raw deal by being demoted to a commission with no clear guidelines as to what is expected of them. Maybe it's time for them to join Terry until a concise list of responsibilities is established for the commission by the city officials who created it. Thank you. As a member of the public.
Thank you. Well, you know, we have appreciated, I have to say I don't always agree with your opinion or positions, but I gotta say, and we've talked about this, you're here for the meetings, you show up, you pay attention, you're even if it's a criticism, it's usually on point. It's really pretty impressive that you put the time in to really become a student of what we're doing.
And we have an opening on the commission.
No pressure, of course, but
you gotta know what you're gonna do here first.
Almost like a book group. Discussion group. All right, well, thank you.
Terry?
Yes.
Also, as a member of the public, I'd like to express the same sentiments that although we've disagreed on some issues for a number of years, I always thought that you were fair
and open and listen to the subject that I that we just agreed on, mm-hmm. and we're very fair, and I appreciate that.
Thank you, sir. I never would have kept my cool the way you did.
Well, as I say, it's always been a lot. I've enjoyed it.
And what I really appreciate is the fact that you can take the pumping capacity of the Hockenham Road Pump Station and turn it into a number about how many Olympic swimming pools can be filled. It's those things that I think are so helpful.
And also make it believable.
Well, that's the thing, right? It takes the... Jim Dostal will ask you how many horsepower and all these other things, but Terry will be like, but how many Olympic swimming pools can be filled by this? Something a little more relatable.
All right. So first, for your consideration, the minutes of the January 28th commission meeting.
Second.
PJ, have you incorporated any?
Yes. Roe on the...
Thank you, Bob.
I think mine was on February
11th.
Thank you, Terry.
Yeah, the 11th was a minute.
Yeah,
thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, really? You're not staying?
Well, I'd love to, but
we've got more minutes.
Okay, so we're good on those minutes?
The 11th was amended.
Okay.
That was it. Yeah.
So we're at the moment, though, we're just looking at the 28th. Do we have a motion to accept those minutes?
We do. Yeah, seconded.
Okay, all in favor of accepting the 20 minutes from the 28th?
Aye.
Aye.
And now February 11th.
Second.
All in favor of accepting those minutes?
Aye.
Aye.
Great.
Terry, would you like to take payment 2015 out of order? We have our senior engineer, David Valletta, here for that.
That sounds great. So, informational number two. Motion to take that out of order?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
David? I've asked David to do the presentation tonight.
So, I know that Terry doesn't want any paperwork, so he doesn't get any. Which is a good thing, because I didn't make quite enough copies. So. Sure. Maybe you could pass these down, and I think Jim and Ned could share a copy. So, I think as you all know, during the Great Recession, we did not do much paving, but we were able to come out of the woods a little bit last year and actually do a pretty substantial paving project. Our new traffic engineer, Alex Bublik, really rose to the occasion, and we did had a contract for well over $1.5 million to do a substantial amount of paving in the city. It came out a little bit late last year, so there's actually one little piece of it left to do this spring, as soon as the weather accommodates that, and that's reclaiming Bridge Road from Francis Street to Jackson Street and redoing that little intersection there at Jackson and Bridge Road with new handicapped accessible crosswalks. We did Jackson Street up to that intersection. So the pavement memo that you have in front of you is a summary of what we're planning to do for FY16. It's more of the same, if you will. We have waiting on release of Chapter 90 funds from the governor. We don't know exactly how much that's going to be, but we anticipate that we're going to be able to do a contract this year that will be in the neighborhood of $1.8 million. That's going to be pending available funding, but we're going to put everything in there that we'd like to do, and our contract allows us to take out streets if need be. So at the beginning of the memo, first of all, we have crack sealing, which is something that we have continued to do over the last few years, even though last year was the year that we did any substantial paving. Last year we did about $100,000 worth of crack sealing. This year we've upped that to $150,000. And that actually has paid off over the years by doing crack sealing. I know historically you've probably heard the famous annual backlog according to VHB, which is a sort of a staggering number. We still get that from VHB, and the interesting thing this year was that the backlog has actually decreased by about $5 million, even though we only did about less than $2 million worth of work last year. So I had Alex look into that, and what he discovered, I said, well, how can that be? And he said, basically what is happening is that because we have aggressively done crack sealing over the last number of years, when VHB comes through to do their annual survey, they only survey a quarter of the streets every year, the pavement condition index of those crack sealed streets has actually gone up a little bit. So since they only survey a quarter of the streets a year, the other remaining streets, the pavement condition index automatically gets degraded in order to maintain what the anticipated pavement condition is. So now that we've gone through several cycles of crack sealing and come back around, it turns out that the pavement condition from all that crack sealing is actually better than what was anticipated from the natural degradation in the program. So we're going to continue to aggressively crack seal streets, particularly focusing on the streets that are in the best condition so that we can maintain those in as good condition as possible for as long as possible. And on the back of page two, you'll see the list of the streets that we anticipate crack sealing this year as part of that contract. That contract has already been put out to bid and awarded for this year. It went to Seal Coating Inc., who's one of two contractors that have been sort of bidding against each other for the last few years. This is the first time we've used Seal Coating Inc., but I think they'll do a good job for us. Our primary focus is on milling and overlaying streets because it's an economical way to maintain and improve the condition of the pavement. So you'll see that the mill and overlay street list is actually quite substantial this year. Further on in your package, you'll also see there is some maps for your enjoyment so that you can see exactly where it is that we're doing these various treatments. And you'll see that we're actually trying to tie in segments that are adjacent to areas that we did last year, so that there's some sense of actually trying to get corridors completed and brought up to snuff in terms of pavement treatment quality. We have a few streets that we sort of tossed in, if you will, at the last minute here. They were streets that we've heard a fair amount of complaint about and have sort of been on the list for a number of years, and we've sort of balked at doing anything with them because, as usual, we also try to balance whether or not there's existing infrastructure under the street that needs to be dealt with at the same time. So we don't want to go ahead and pave a street if we know that there are infrastructure issues that need to be dealt with first. Of course, if we get into replacing infrastructure, it becomes a much larger project, and historically, those projects have tended to get kicked down the road a little bit. So the prime examples would be Milton Street, for instance. We've been putting that off for a number of years because we know that there eventually needs to be some consolidation of sewer in the roadway and some drainage work done down there. It's in such deplorable condition at this point that we decided that we're going to just do a mill and overlay of 1.5 inches on that just to provide some relief to the neighborhood down there. Last year we tried doing a lot of box paving on those kinds of roadway conditions, and it turned out that really wasn't particularly efficient or effective for the department to do that work. And it's about the same cost for us to actually hire somebody. It's actually cheaper for us to hire somebody to do a mill and overlay than it is to have our own crews go out with a box paver and try to do the best they can to just do an overlay on the roads. So the three that we've added here we know some of infrastructure work needs to happen in eventually would be Milton Street, Woodlawn Avenue, which is a main thoroughfare that we've already worked on, Jackson Street and Prospect Street, so we're trying to tie that corridor together, and Pomeroy Terrace.
So what's the work in Woodlawn, the utility work that needs to be done in Woodlawn?
The primary issue in Woodlawn is actually just drainage work, and we think that there's a stream that comes through Look Park actually and discharges at the edge of Woodlawn.
Child's
Park. I'm sorry, Child's Park.
Okay.
And we're looking at just doing a simple drainage fix there to try to address that so that it doesn't create a problem with the mill and overlay that we're doing. We don't have any, the underlying infrastructure is in okay condition. So I think that we can make it a worthwhile bridging project by just doing this one little drainage fix. Our initial take on it was that we would probably need to look at it in a larger context, but the concern again was that we'd end up looking at a full-blown project that would kick down the road for a few years, and the condition wouldn't improve otherwise, and it would spend a lot of staff time trying to patch the potholes out there. And, Rich Parcelletti told me that he had already put down, as of yesterday morning, 4 tons of patch material on Woodlawn and hadn't gotten halfway through it. So
there's a really nice trench patch there on Woodlawn.
Is there?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not very wide though, but it's really
but it's holding up really well. Is everything around it that's
yeah,
it's holding everything else in place? Yeah.
It's the gas line.
It's the gas line. Okay.
Dave, would Pomeroy Terrace be the same thing?
Yes, it would.
Because that's some drainage issue.
Right. We know there are drainage issues there, absolutely. And again, that's Ned was telling me that there was a sewer separation project, I believe, in Pomeroy Terrace, and they put a deep sewer in Pomeroy Terrace and then used the sewer as the old sewer as the drain line, and it's clearly undersized. But again, that's a project that's going to have to be a little bit further down the road, and the condition of the road is in such bad shape right now that, you know, basically Rich told me, he said, if you don't do an overlay it, I'm going to go box pave it. And it's like, oh, okay, well, we'll do what we can. The one thing that we're trying new this year is something called Fulton Place Recycling with an overlay. So this is a process that Alex went and looked at up in Warwick, and it is a milling and pavement process train where you basically have a milling machine that is hooked up right behind a paving machine. So it mills the up to 4 inches of pavement right into the paving machine, and then they add aggregate and bitumen as necessary to essentially rejuvenate the pavement, and then they lay the pavement down in a continuous process. So the result is that you end up with a rejuvenated and smoother, more of a plain surface than what you had before, but the pavement is sort of an open graded and somewhat porous, so you need to put an overlay over that. This process is something that is unfortunately only viable on roadways that don't have structures in them, because it interrupts the process and makes it more expensive. But the two roads that we flagged for this, section of Reservoir Road and a section of Chesterfield Road, are good candidates for that, and they would otherwise be reclaimed roads, which is the most expensive process that we have. It's about twice the cost of a mill and overlay. Gary.
What does HMA stand for?
I'm sorry, hot mixed asphalt.
Okay.
I didn't spell it out because it would have changed the layout of the page.
HMA is hot mixed, but I didn't know if they're A class. Thank you.
And so, as you can see, we have a couple of streets that we're reclaiming here, but we're trying to limit our exposure on that unless we absolutely have to try to have a reclaim project that would be more likely to be associated with almost a full roadway reconstruction where we're doing infrastructure replacements such as Hinckley Street. We are finishing up we did a section of Bridge Street last year from near Pomeroy Terrace up to Orchard Street. And then there's just a short little section from Orchard up to Grant Avenue, which is the beginning of the state layout. And we want to complete that to the state layout. So again, we're trying to put all the pieces together and make some continuity and sense out of the paving contract. We're also doing some rubberized chip seal this year. We did Barrett Street last year as sort of an experiment. It seems to be a good process. We have a better handle on it. And again, it seems to work better on rural roads. So we are doing a section of Sylvester Road, from where we ended last year with the reclaim project all the way out to Chesterfield Road. And then we're doing a section of Audubon Road from about the top of the hill almost to Kennedy Road. The last little couple hundred feet of Kennedy Road is needs to be reclaimed, so we've got that as part of that process, so that we've made that connection. And then finally, as I say, at the bottom on box paving, we're really trying to shy away from that so that we can have the professionals do the paving and let the DPW staff focus on other tasks. So I'm more than happy to take questions if you've had a chance to look at some of the maps. And
it's on the website?
Not yet, no. This is hot off the presses. But it will be on the website, and we will have this information posted once we get closer to bidding.
An estimate of what it costs for a lane mile?
For lane mile. I have estimates for square yard. So if you want to do the conversion, you can do that. We do it because the the roadways vary anywhere from 20 feet to 40 or 50 feet wide. You know, Prospect Street is probably 45 feet of pavement out there.
Okay. And this Warwick method.
Yes.
That's something that Amherst tried.
No, that was hot in place. So the difference with hot in place is that all that they really do is just it's a more cumbersome process because the treatment train needs to be longer. They have large machines with huge gas heaters underneath them that have to go in advance of a scarifier that just scarifies about an inch and a half of the pavement and basically just re-rolls it and lays it back down. Whereas this is a cold process that actually mills all the pavement, tosses it into the paver, mixes it up with more bitumen and aggregate if needed, and then immediately lays it back down hot and rolls it out. So we're hoping that it's a better process.
And then the hot mix asphalt goes on top the next day or something like that?
No, actually, as I understand it, you have to wait several weeks for the...
It happens later.
Yeah, it happens later. So that'll actually be, the cold in place is a specialized process, and that'll actually be a separate contract, but the overlay itself would go under the main pavement contract.
Two different processes.
Right.
Separated by 2 weeks.
2 weeks, something like that, yeah.
So Dave, so the issue with box paving last year, my understanding is, I think we have 11 highway workers.
Total in that department, yes.
And it takes six guys to run the box paver plus Richie. So basically seven people. And he could never quite put together seven people for more than a few minutes at a time to substantially tackle paving issues. So I was wondering, is there a way to get a 12th or a 13th or a 14th worker? Is it... You've done the cost benefit, and it makes more sense to just farm it out.
Yeah, I think there are two other things to consider. One is that the box paver is a limited width; it's only 7 or 8 feet wide.
So
a professional paver is going to be able to do a roadway in two passes. They're going to have a 12 to 14 foot swath they can do at any given time, and it's a professional paving machine. And we are paying about, say, in the mid-70s per ton FOB, and we're trucking it, we're supplying the labor, and we're laying it down, whereas our pavement contract is about $72 per ton in place, the whole thing.
Okay.
So I don't really think that it's kind of a no-brainer. Okay. I mean, and I think, you know, I appreciate very much Richie's willingness to step out there and want to do this, and I think it was really just some level of frustration of seeing the condition of the roads and feeling like I have to do something with this, and if it's not going to happen, I'm going to do it. So I think that's where the impetus came from.
How much was it a ton for box paving?
It would be whatever our asphalt is per ton when we do our asphalt contract, mm-hmm. but then inclusive, of course, behind that is all the labor costs, seven people to do it.
Ned, is it your impression that the mayor is on board with kind of a steady amount from the general fund budget for paving?
Yes, that's my understanding at this point. The capital improvements are going to be presented by the finance committee, I believe it's next Wednesday or Thursday night, to the city council. So we'll see what they're actually going to put in for the five-year plan for pavement management.
And we're looking for 0.5% of the city budget. Would we be happy at $500,000 if it was steady? Or
very happy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So 0.5%, that's all we're asking for pavement.
And we have, you know, the engineering department has a certain capacity as well in terms of number of projects it can manage at any given time. So we feel a certain constraint in terms of size of the project from that point of view, too. So we've kept that in mind in terms of determining the size of this contract, and it's I think it's as much as we'd be able to handle for the season.
A question back to Woodlawn in terms of the drainage there. It sounds like the drainage issue has been created in Child's Park. So are we addressing the drainage, or are we asking the trustees to...
There's a combination of things going on there. I think part of it is a maintenance issue. So there's a discharge to a swale on Child's Park right at the edge of Woodlawn, which would be in the right-of-way, and then theoretically the water travels down that swale a couple of hundred feet to a catch basin, which is frequently covered in debris and is not always clear. So if it doesn't go into that catch basin, then it goes out into the road and needs to go another 400 feet before it gets to the next catch basin. So I think there's some maintenance of the swale that is required that would certainly help keep the water in that swale. And then our proposal is to put a stub pipe from that first catch basin further off the road and put another basin out there so that we could, Doug would like to see some sort of a water quality swale developed in there as part of more of a low impact design, rather than trying to catch those flows from Child's Park right at the discharge. So that's the intention at this point, is just to put a catch basin further off the road and establish a swale in there between the discharge and that catch basin and keep it where it needs to be.
So is that our maintenance issue or the trustees?
I don't know. I haven't really had that discussion.
Isn't there some curbing there that's not functioning, and that swale just sort of flows through the curbing? That sound right?
That sounds right. So that's what happens right now, is that there's at the catch basin there's a break in the curbing, so that the water coming down the swale is supposed to go through that break and get into the catch basin. So the intention would be to put a catch basin outside the pavement and close up that curb so that the water in the street stays in the street, and the water coming from that comes out of Child's Park would go right into the drainage system before getting into the street.
Thank you.
Any other questions for comments? Did it cover everything then?
I just want to say I love having maps this year. Yes. I thought it was great. And I second Dick's comment about him, and I know why he said it's possible, because I will keep this with me for the next 2 months while I get questions from.
Okay, good. Yeah, we will definitely get it up there. Just one last thing, just so that people know, there is an 11x17 in here with a bunch of highlighted yellow on there. And this is just to show the VHB software. As I say, we have a pavement condition index, which tells us what level of treatment a given roadway would require. So this is for mill and overlay, and the range of PCI, or pavement condition index, for mill and overlay is between 61 and 72 as a general rule. So 72 being the better condition. So we take that pavement condition index along with some other factors, including the average daily traffic, the cost to do the treatment, and the expected life associated with that, according to the equation just underneath the heading there, to calculate what's called a benefit value. And the benefit value basically is giving you some idea of where you're getting your best bang for your buck in terms of where you're spending your money. And so the intention is to, with the ranking according to benefit value, which is the right-hand column, is to sort of target those streets, and then in conjunction with our local knowledge and trying to create some sort of network of continuity as we go along here. So you'll see that most of the streets that we've chosen are near the top of the list here in terms of benefit value.
What would make a street like Camden make that list as opposed to some others? Just curious.
The only reason, if you see that, one of the things that we felt when we were looking at this was that over the past few years and this year as well, there's been a lot of work in the outer wards, in Ward 6 and Ward 7, and we felt as though the downtown area was getting neglected a little bit. So one of the things that we do is to try to pick streets that have a low pavement condition index and are on the verge of dropping into a reclaim. So we want to try to catch those before they drop into the more expensive category. And Hamden Street was, as you can see at the bottom end, it's in the 62 for PCI, and it was more downtown. So we're just trying to spread the wealth a little bit without trying to pick favorites or appear to be picking favorites.
So is there a total? Any place I don't see it, but Ned had mentioned at the last meeting that we've got $36 million. I noticed that was in reference to one of the minutes that we had. It may have been the January meeting. Paving projects, we've got $36 million.
Oh, the backlog?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's what I was referring to earlier. I think last year the paving backlog was $41 million. So
so I think that there's probably some reason to make the public aware of the fact that over the course of the cost of the last 2 years' worth of paving, which has been very noticeable, certainly will continue to be noticeable this year with what you're doing on top of what happened last year after a long period of time, and it was hardly noticeable. And the relationship to properly funding, whether it's the $500,000 a year that capital improvements might provide, it still depends to a great extent on what we get from the Chapter 90 funding. I mean, to be able to make any significant understanding things correctly. So I mean, we can do all the planning we should in order to identify those areas where we have the most significant problems, and it makes some headway for a period of time, and then immediately fall behind again without Chapter 90 money becoming consistently available. So I keep on harping on this, but I think at some point we've got to really, I don't know how the best way to approach this as an advisory board, but I think we've got to press upon the capital improvements people as well as the city council. If we're going to look at trying to deal with our roads in a serious and consistent way, it has to be properly funded rather than sporadically funded, which we're subject to just because the sources for this funding are outside of our control, even under the best of circumstances, where we're getting $500,000 a year, hopefully, from capital improvements over a period of time. That's a small dent in the $36 million, which will be $40 million in another couple of years if we don't catch up on it. So
I think we're making
progress. We're ignoring a lot of the obvious here by just making ourselves feel good about getting this funding when we get it, and it certainly makes great sense that the methods that you're going about, it seems to me anyway, the methods that you're going about identifying where the money can be put to the best use for the community, but it's a much larger problem than that. And I think it's up to us to advocate for that.
Absolutely.
Personally, I think that's an important,
I think we can advocate,
that can be an important
on,
part
advocate
of
on
our
the
responsibility
as well.
Ned, yeah. Is it your impression that there's much doubt about the 500?
That's my understanding, what's going to take place.
But you think it's pretty solid?
I do.
Because thinking about what you said, Pam, there's actually a great story to tell. We invested $2.5 million last year.
If that.
And the number dropped by almost $10 million?
No.
It
dropped
from
by $4.5 million.
$4.5 million. So we get 2 to 1.
Yeah.
Okay.
It may be more than the $2 million we did last year. I think it's also an accumulation of the several hundred thousands from previous years of crack sealing that have come around, and we've seen the benefit of that start to be reaped.
Still, there's a multiplier effect.
There has to be.
You know, as opposed to not getting it and being and ignoring them.
I think we've made it pretty clear to the mayor that that we would prefer to see some consistent funding over the years. Originally, the capital improvements had been sort of a year on, a year off. And from our planning point of view, it's a lot better to have something consistent and uniform from year to year.
George?
I think the only way to get consistent funding is through an enterprise system. And that is going to go very big, as you can imagine. So maybe the next chairman's job or chairperson's job would be to get an enterprise system for paving. And I wish you luck.
Or bonding it.
Bonding, unfortunately, Pat, is subject to the city council.
Yeah, I know that. I know that. But I think to buy into this at this point, that's, it takes that kind of courage, I think. It's a capital asset.
Yeah, through capital improvements, you know, I think the city bonds. But to have a consistent policy, a funding mechanism, the only way to do it right now, what I can think of, is through an enterprise system.
But what would be the source of revenue?
Toll roads.
Well, you need a state. You need a state law, first of all, to allow you to set up an enterprise fund for that.
Of course. Yeah.
So you know, it'd be a small step, probably, to do that. But
if you look historically, what happened with the city, with water, sewer, now, which were saved, by the way, because of the enterprise system, and now you have the stormwater management, which, you know, was in shambles. Budget-wise, in actual fact, back in 2001 was the time when we took all the money out of the stormwater as a line item. It was eliminated because of budget cuts. So you have to eliminate the possibility of depending on something on the budget side if you want to do it consistently.
I mean, it's interesting that the state legislature voted to index the gas tax every year to account for inflation, and that was approved by the legislature. And then there was a ballot question put on there this past year, and the voters didn't vote for that, right? So it was the state's intent to try to keep up with some amount of funding with money that would roll into Chapter 90 and other things. For paving and infrastructure management on the transportation side, and that people voted that down. So it's interesting on a statewide level to see where people's thoughts are at.
Yes.
Thank you for adding the column with the average daily travel, because I think that's really helpful to look at. All right. So Pat mentioned the public, you know, letting the public know. I think we're going to let them know by the fact that we're paving some roads with 12,500 vehicle trips every day. You know, if you're used to driving on Upper Prospect, you certainly know something happened, and it's wonderful. Mm-hmm. That was pretty bad. And I happen to go in Woodlawn all the time. So excited about that.
Yeah.
Is Woodlawn on this list?
It is. Well, it's not on this one because
It's not on this one because it's actually a reclaim.
Right.
So it's worse. Yeah.
It's worse. It's dropped below the 62. Right. It's dropped into the next
If you think driving your car on it, you should ride your bicycle on it.
So that's always the frustration. That's the frustration.
You got that trench. No. You fit on that trench pad.
You fit on the trench.
The trench works great. As long as it's like well after dark or before sunrise, then there's no competition. Yeah. But I'll tell you, not in the right spot for a bicycle.
So that's somewhat been the frustration for us, Mike, is that someplace the road like Woodlawn is clearly a reclaim as far as our software and VHB is concerned. Mm-hmm. Well, if it's a reclaim, then we're going to spend a lot of money we're going to reclaim it.
Yep.
Well, if we're going to reclaim it, are we going to do all the utilities? What kind of condition are the utilities in? Mm-hmm. Well, now it's a big project. When are we going to design this? Is it really something that needs to be done right now? So we're doing a little bit of an experiment this year saying, okay, there's some of these like Woodlawn that we know we're probably not going to get to it in the next 5 years for infrastructure. It's not a high priority. Let's just mill it the best we can and give it a top coat that will give us 5, 6, 7 years. It's going to be better than trying to send our crews out there to try to box pave it.
Oh,
and it's going to be less expensive.
Yep.
So that's the thinking.
That's probably support doing something to win. Yeah.
I don't think there's anybody that doesn't.
I know.
This is a nice presentation.
This is great.
Thank you, David.
Look what's next. Okay, so election of chairperson to the Public Works Commission. I don't know, do we have any candidates?
I didn't have time to put that together.
A little campaign.
So I decided against it.
Okay.
Shouldn't you step in up into it?
No.
No, actually, Roe was fairly clear when she became vice chair that she had no aspirations beyond that office, that lofty office.
And I'm happy to stay as vice chair, but Gary and I are stalwarts of the.
I'm happy to sit over here in this corner.
Yeah. We'll do claims.
I could pass plates to the new chair if we had Kate to do.
Mike?
So, like, I'd be willing. Not that I'm actively chasing.
I'd like to nominate Mike.
Yes. Second.
I'd like to second that.
That's an affirmation.
Yeah, you got it, Mike.
I didn't finish my speech.
You were afraid what you would say.
I know.
I personally think that you would be a wonderful person to take over this role. You've been here long enough to establish some credibility and to put in your hours and to show us your amazing capability in terms of leadership. Seriously. The private ways, doing the spreadsheet.
You may recall we threw that out.
just as an aside.
It was much better than the starting place we had.
Right, exactly. And it leads to different parameters like this.
Right.
And I think, like Terry, you're very good with the public. I mean, he set a great example. You know, considering the public, making sure that we have a web presence and that we are, you know, in the 21st century, that was really an amazing thing that you pushed for. And I really have a lot of respect for that. I think you'll carry that on.
You think so?
I do.
All right. Are there any other candidates? All right, so let's declare the nominations closed. So
we can vote by secret ballot.
We'll close our eyes.
All right. So
heads down, heads up.
So the question on the floor is, would you like to approve of Mike Parsons as the new chairman of the Public Works Advisory Commission? All in favor of that?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, great. I think that's it.
I think I should abstain.
By acclamation.
I'm going to abstain.
I believe that's by acclamation.
Thank you.
Would you like to come up here?
And thank you for stepping forward.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. We're going to switch seats?
You're going to love this chair. I kid you not. It's the best chair in the room.
Oh, wow. It's got wheels.
Yeah, maybe I'll bring this with me.
Any motion to adjourn?
No. The sponge, no.
You don't want the sponge?
No.
Yes. I have considered that.
What?
Okay. Shall we continue?
Yeah.
Next item under new business is number 2, hotel bridge support letter.
So under this item, I sent this out about a week ago to you, a PDF file of League Civic Association has been working to get Hotel Bridge on the National Register of Historic Places. They're looking for a support letter from the Public Works Commission. That's why I put it on the agenda so there could be a discussion on it. They've actually have the application pretty much all set to go. We've been actually helping them with some maps and some graphics on it. And I expect probably in the next 2 to 3 weeks they'll be submitting it. So they're just looking for a support letter from through the commission on this.
Make a motion that we sign on to a letter of support seeking the designation.
Second.
Any more discussion?
Just, well, background, Ned and I went and met with the Leeds Civic Association, or the, maybe it's a subcommittee just about the bridge. The hotel bridge?
No, you're talking Bay State Village.
I'm talking Bay, never mind my comment.
But how'd the meeting go?
It was a very nice meeting. They seemed like lovely people.
And they have an old bridge there, too?
They do, yeah. And they're working on the same thing.
That one has cars going over it, too.
Yeah.
Unlike the other one.
Any more discussion? All in favor of submitting the letter of support?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
I'll drop that letter for you.
Thank you, Ned. Under old business, any comments from this group regarding the environmental protections and solid waste reduction ordinance that I think of as being just related to banning single-use plastic bags, but there might be other aspects to it. Thin.
Yes. Right. I passed my comments.
You did. Thank you.
I've read it. I didn't have any comments. I don't know if anyone else does.
Comment. I don't have any comments.
Make a comment?
Sure.
It's kind of ironic for the city to be selling trash bags and be in the trash bag business, which is made out of plastic, and then turning around and saying you can't use trash to other people who are plastic.
It's a different way.
Plastic is plastic. You want to recycle the stuff, that would be a different start. If you set up a thing here to collect plastic, like Stop and Shop does, then you wouldn't be hypocritical.
Okay. Any other comments? I don't think we need a vote on this. I think you're just collecting comments and feedback to the city council.
That's correct.
Okay.
So I'll forward those comments from Rowan, the reuse committee on that.
Thank you.
Good. Thank you. Next item is on private ways. This is you, Ned.
Yep. Just a quick update. Bottoms Road is in the surveyor's hands right now. Seneca took a little turn. The Public Works Committee of the City Council asked the mayor and city solicitor Sewall about their vote and what it meant. And Alan wrote back that the two no's basically meant a yes to proceed with it becoming a public way. The mayor has since sent an email to the city council that says that I will veto any council order accepting Center Court as a public way, and pursuant to Article 3, Section 3.3, a two-thirds vote of the city council is required to override a mayoral vote. I hope the city council will factor this into any decision requiring the city to expend staff time and legal resources attempting to turn a driveway and a parking lot into a public way. Thank you for reaching out to me and the opportunity to give my input. So with that, Center Court is basically stopping in its tracks until I get an order from the mayor to proceed with it, just so you're aware of that.
Thank you.
Well, that's a good, it's good to have that resolution, a resolution of the issue, mm-hmm. because I attended the last Council Public Works Committee meeting, and there was a lot of question about where this was all headed, so I think that's helped to have that clarification. Next on the agenda is setting a meeting date for the Comprehensive Wastewater Management Plan.
So this is an ongoing discussion. Jim's been working very hard with Kleinfelder trying to look at the 0 to 5 year plan, 5 to 10, and all the way up to a 20 year plan, and put them in a reflective order with the cost attached to it. It's still trying to figure out what we're going to do with it, but maybe it might be too mature to actually set a meeting date at this point, but I hope that within the next couple weeks that we can get together and have a meeting on it, just so you're aware of that as soon as we get everything in order. We have a meeting with the mayor next Wednesday. I think that will help define what we're going to be doing also. And then, of course, there's the process of wrapping up the plan itself, which we hopefully can get done by the end of the summer at the latest.
Are you thinking of a meeting with the subcommittee that we had?
Or that's correct. That's what I was thinking, because you're the most familiar with the plan.
Right.
And so that was you, Dave, and Gary?
Gary, yes. The three of us.
Yeah.
Okay.
So to make you aware, we're still working on it, and hopefully get the plan wrapped up soon.
That covers that item?
Yeah. I just wanted, do we want to talk about dates? Are we trying to set up a date for that subcommittee?
We can set up a date. I don't have a problem with that. I want to make sure we have all the information ready for you before we set a date.
Oh, okay.
We would be ready.
What's that, Jim?
We would be ready. I mean, I'm ready for a meeting. I think the only thing that's, you know, we're meeting with the mayor next week to talk to him about some of the projects that are in the CIP.
Mm-hmm.
So.
A meeting just within the city or with the consultant?
We're having an internal meeting, Ed and I, and the mayor and finance director. And
no, I meant, are you ready for a meeting? It seems to me it's been so long since we've met that at least a meeting with city people would be appropriate.
Yeah, I think
and,
so.
And even if we don't have everything we need to discuss the other issues.
Yeah, I think it would make sense. I mean, we had, it's been a while since the subcommittee has met.
Right.
But basically what we've been focused on is grouping priorities of projects into a timeline based on priority and then figuring out what the schedule would be for it. It's a 20-year planning period. So the step that we're at would be to talk about the groups of projects and the way that we've started to prioritize them and have a discussion about that. And then, you know, we're at the same time in the meeting with the mayor, we'll be talking to the mayor and the city finance director about, you know, wider implications over how that CIP gets drawn up. Right, and so with the CWMP, like anything, it's a planning document, it's a 20-year time frame. Your certainty, your first 5 years should be pretty good in that time frame. But, you know, there's a list of projects that the subcommittee has seen that extends beyond 5 years as a 20-year plan. And as it gets a little foggier as you go out, but the goal of the plan is to make the city aware of all the different areas of the system that need work. So it might be good, even if we meet, just to remember what the heck we talked about the last time.
I think it would.
Yeah.
I need to look at the week after next, so the week of the March 23rd. Any day but Wednesday is best.
What time would we be meeting?
Do I do a morning meeting like we, does that
sure,
work?
Sure, we can find that.
For you fellas?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any day but Wednesday.
Well, Friday, 27th?
Sure.
What time works for everybody?
What time works? What time?
What have we done before? Start at 8 or 8:30?
Sure.
8 o'clock?
Yeah, I was going to say if you can start at 8.
That's fine with me. David?
Okay.
That's all right.
So March 27th, 8 a.m.
All right. Next is under information, number one, an update on contracts. Let's see,
so
what's the handout?
You have a handout here tonight. This came out of one of the past meetings that we had that there's curiosity since the board wasn't signing contracts, were contracts being signed by the department, the value of them, and what enterprise fund or funding source they came from. These are everything but time extensions. Time extensions had no money attached to them, so they weren't included. But this is what's been signed by myself and Jim to go down to the mayor's office for signatures. So just so you're aware of that, majority of them are water related. Timber harvesting, some forestry stewardship plans, SCADA support, and so on. Some of it came from capital improvements of the general fund from FY15, which was the Clement Street Bridge study, and then Chapter 90 for crack sailing.
Oh,
negative
amounts? Negative amount means we're getting paid for timber.
Income.
Oh, God.
Income.
Can you
unusual
talk about the water main project on Pine and Florence Road, what
sure
that schedule's like?
Sure, I can go over that. Actually, David probably is best to speak, or Jim, because
I could speak to the project.
Great.
We have it's multiple water main replacements on the streets that are listed, Riverbank Road, Winslow Avenue. Riverbank Road have had a history of a lot of main breaks there. It's an old AC line, so we're looking at replacing that. Winslow Avenue is sort of a key street that was identified in the Tain and Howard report. In a water line that's in poor condition, so we're looking at trying to replace that. The Pine Street Florence Road water main replacement project was moved to the head of the class because of the transmission main that lies in the bed of the Mill River. So if you walk by 221 Pine, you look over into the river, you can see the water main. It's a little disconcerting, and it's been a project that we've had highlighted to take care of. So the idea there is to bring the main up and put it in a utility bank on the bridge, get it out of the river. So the schedule, we bid this in the wintertime. We got good prices from the contractors. Gonzales was the low bidder. They're expecting about a 9 or 10 week construction duration for the job. So they're going to be starting as soon as the weather breaks in the spring, with Winslow Avenue and Riverbank as the two projects that will be done first. They're pretty small sections of water main that they'll take care of. And then the Pine Street and Florence Road project is more complicated because there's a bridge crossing and a lot of traffic issues, management issues, and other things that need to happen there. So,
I would just want to add from the pavement point of view that rather than doing a permanent trench patch on the Pine and Montauk and Florence road sections, that's included in our mill and overlay section. So we'll get a new section, we'll get a new pavement, full width pavement section throughout there, as well as doing a little redesign of the Ryan Road, Florence Road intersection to try to make that a little bit safer, tighten up the intersection a little bit, make the crossing a little bit shorter. So we're trying to, again, combine these infrastructure projects with some of the surface work as well.
Good. That was my question. So so you'll let Gonzales finish his project before the pavement has.
Yep.
Great.
Is that a location that's ever been considered for a roundabout? With Ryan, I don't know if it lines up that well. We're Pine and, there's just a lot going on there. And it's, you know, got that piece at the corner on the island itself, which would be a taking name, but I wonder if that's ever, in the discussions that have taken place, I know there's been emerging opinion about the benefit of roundabouts after the success of the one up near Look Park, and I'm just wondering if that's another, because it's just really gooey.
Pioneer Valley Planning Commission did a study on that, probably has to be around 2005 or 2006, and I don't believe that was one of the recommendations that came out of it. They came back with some enhanced signage and line painting and so on. In fact, we were trying to get out there before winter set in and put in some portable speed bumps, just in collecting data, how we could slow traffic down, coming down the 20-mile-an-hour hill into Ryan Road, on Florence Road. That's a spring project now at this point. So we're still looking at ways to slow traffic down and make a little more safe intersection down there.
Yeah, well, that would be, I mean, that you would think that could be accomplished with a roundabout, whether one could fit in there or not. You know, I don't know. It just seems like it's a very odd section of roads intersecting and not intersecting where they should.
Well, it used to be that Ryan Road used to run straight and then turn right onto the bridge. Right. And they redesigned it when I was a kid. Mm. Put that little loop thing in.
Mm-hmm. Just a question.
Dave?
Yeah, the Clement Street Bridge, I just wondered what step is going to be.
That's a study, re-up in the study that was done a number of years ago, looking at stage fixes of the bridge and long term, whether or not it's going to be cost effective. So that was a study that Greenman Pedersen, who did the previous study, had put forth. We reviewed the proposal from them. The mayor approved it.
That was something we considered a couple of months ago, I think.
And it was same more expensive?
Pardon me?
Wasn't it more expensive at that point?
Well, it was more expensive than we thought it was going to be.
Yeah.
We were hoping that it would be a $20,000 study, and it wasn't.
Oh, so this is the same price
as it was.
Any other questions on contracts? Jim? Sure, thank you.
I don't have a question, but I thought I would just elaborate for a minute on the logging contract. contracts, the timber harvesting contracts, you'll see that there are a number of them that are there. And those are a follow-up to the red pine control problem that we had Nicole and Mike Moore here a few meetings ago talking about that. So what you're seeing here is timber harvesting and work in a variety of stands in the watersheds to deal with the red pine issue. There'll be an article, I think, in the Gazette tomorrow about the work that started out in Roberts Meadow. So if you drive down through that part of town, you'll see some of the work has started there with red pine removal. And the CDM Smith contract for control of invasives vegetation, a $28,000 contract, is related to looking at Oriental bittersweet issues and related grape control problems that we have in the watershed. So we had talked to Mike Maury at length in one of the meetings about what happens when we log and remove the dead red pines, and if we have invasives problems, what are we going to do to control those? So that CDM Smith study is intended to help us identify sort of best management practices that we can use and what other public water suppliers are using in situations like this. So that again is a follow-up to things that we had talked about in previous meetings of the board.
Okay. Anything else? All right. Move on to number three, proposed public works assessment.
So, conversing with the mayor about this year's budget and additional staffing requirements or requests that I had, he decided he wanted to go forth with a organizational and management assessment of the department. He went to City Council last Thursday night and had a first reading, which was positive, that the City Council appropriated $23,000 to conduct a comprehensive organizational and management assessment of the Department of Public Works to include operations, service levels, infrastructure management, organizational structure, and staffing levels. So I want to make you aware of that. He requested a proposal from three different companies and only one responded, and that's the one he's currently looking at. It has to go through another council meeting on, that would be the 19th, would be the second meeting on that. So I want to make you aware of that.
Public Works assessment or the Department of Public Works?
Department of Public Works.
So the administrative aspect of Department of Public Works, not public work for the entire city?
Our staff here, our needs.
I wasn't clear from that.
Delivery of services to the citizens, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. Right. So now how does that affect your budgetary preparations? I mean, because we talked in January about the...
Well, the mayor's instructed me that we can't budget additional staff until we have our meeting next Wednesday. So this is one of the reasons why we're trying to figure out the budget, because don't have a clear direction from the mayor what he's going to allow and not allow.
So, but this report, this staffing report, what's the timeline on it, did he say?
I believe he's trying to get it done in a 12-week period.
12-week?
12-week.
You mean like period. April, May, and June?
Something like that.
Okay. So, it seems we're in limbo.
I mean, the conversations I had, I mean, looking at Superintendent of Wastewater again, that has been gone for quite a period of time.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that now we have the CMON requirements coming at us, we have a new NPDES permit, NPDES discharge permit, the wastewater plant. We have all these capital improvements that we're looking to do at the plant. How are we going to manage that without additional staff? Same with other waterside, we're looking at a watershed foreman, because once we do start all these logging activities, there needs to be more eyes on up there, and especially if we have to do manual invasive species control, who's going to take care of that and lead that group up there?
But we shouldn't necessarily assume that this is going to be something that wouldn't be helpful. I mean, this assessment report theoretically will point out those areas.
I'm hoping. I support it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I'm just curious. How do you start a year? Of course, if it's done, I suppose by June.
Right. I'm just not sure how the $23,000. How are you going to drill down too far with a consulting team, mm-hmm. and what's going to come out of it? I can forward you or link you to copies of other assessment reports this one company has done. I think you'll see the flavor of what they're looking to do here.
I think we'd like to see that.
Yeah.
You should do that, please.
Yeah, I'll do that.
And what's the name of the company?
Matrix Consulting Group.
Okay. And also, the board itself has made comments about your staffing. So is that something that will be shared with Matrix?
I expect that company? Matrix will be discussing that with you also. Okay. They're looking to seek out staff on all levels and the commission for comments.
Okay. Yeah, sure. Wasn't there a report, departmental report done early in Claire's
2001.
Right.
It was done by Municipal Resources, Inc., MRI.
MRI.
But it really was more focused on communications with the department, with the public, and other departments also.
It wasn't staffing?
There's very little with staffing in that.
There were organizational changes made based on that report. Right.
Right, but I don't recall anyone being hired for new changes out of there.
So it was an organizational blueprint for interacting with the public in a more productive way?
A lot of it was. Better communications from the department. George, actually, I was fresh in the department when that came out. Not to shout out to George, but he worked with that consultant extensively with Guilford, the assistant director back then for that.
Right. Well, no, it's just one of them. I mean, it's the reports. I wonder if, because the next item on the budget is the next item on the agenda is the budget.
Right.
It seems hard to talk about a budget in a productive way without understanding in advance what the...
I understand that, too.
Right. Anything else on this topic? All right, move on to the last one. Budget for FY16.
Thank you, George. Working on the budget, we've submitted to MUNIS anyways, the general side. Parks, cemetery, streets. The enterprise funds are kind of in limbo at the moment. We're gathering all the information as to projects to be done, equipment to be purchased, things of that nature on the capital side. It's a matter of sitting down with the mayor next week to provide more positive direction before we can, I think, sit down and really share a lot with you. So I do expect that we'll be having a budget meeting soon. I just don't know exactly when yet.
Okay. Questions on this?
Yeah.
How are you going to do a budget without the staff?
Right? It does seem complicated, I guess.
Yeah.
And with respect to our advisory role, and the budget and the process, and where do we see our responsibilities going forward in terms of, are we just going to react to a budgetary presentation that you'll make that will be something that you've already discussed with, because I know we're all asking ourselves the same question. Will that be something that you've already discussed with the mayor to get some indication of where his priorities are, or are we going to be weighing in on what we think maybe the priorities budgetarily should be?
I think you weigh in. The issue is that you're an advisory board now, and you're not setting anything as far as, a vote coming out.
Yeah.
The mayor's in charge of this, and he's making recommendations for city council for approval. He's made that very clear to me.
But we can make recommendations to the mayor.
I think
they may carry no weight, but
exactly.
We can make recommendations.
Does he condone you bringing the budget to us to review?
No, he doesn't. He likes the input you had in the past and so on, but he's got the final say.
No, I understand that, but does he approve of you bringing the budget to us to review?
I don't believe he has a problem with that. That okay. He's never mentioned that being an issue.
Okay.
I suspect he may want us to do it.
It could be. It's just one of these questions that we really don't have a good feel for. So I'm assuming that if the staff brings us the budget, then we review it. And if we think things ought to be changed, then we agree to those changes. We vote on them and send them back with our recommendations.
Well, if it's about priorities, that would be a reasonable thing to advise on, what we think the priorities might be.
Mm-hmm.
I have a particular interest in the CDM scope of services, for instance, that we talked about back in January with respect to the fairgrounds project, because I'm on that development team. I'd like to see that project advance with the transportation bill funding, the $3 million
you know, but how do we talk about a position, getting back to asking Jim that question at that January meeting? You know, it's a, you've got a full plate of already, it would seem, in terms of the departmental priorities with respect to the projects that we were briefed on here today by Dave and so forth. And, if there's $3 million that's available to us from a transportation bond bill to resolve a decades-old issue that has haunted this department back in the days when George gave us our first estimate when on the fairgrounds group, but to tackle it of $3 million, you know, it's much greater amount of money than that. It would seem to me that that should be a priority. So, I mean, I'd like to be able to weigh in on that so that in the discussions with the mayor that we could find out whether it's also a priority for him. Or do we, getting back to David's question, do we go directly to the mayor and talk to him about that? You know, it's an odd spot we find ourselves in here. And I feel somewhat complicated by it because I have a meeting at 8 o'clock this morning with the fairgrounds people where they're asking me that question. You know, and you've got the people from EDC there and everybody else trying to push this economic development opportunity along, only to find out that we don't know whether we've got we've got to get CDM scope of services done, mm-hmm. and we've got to be able to figure out whether how we can move this project along. And I wonder whether it's, I'd like to be able to figure out where we can, you know, help and advise. It's unclear to me.
Yeah. Well, on that same note, when I think about the wastewater plan that we're going to review in a couple of weeks, there's a whole bunch of projects out there that are going to be funded through sewer rates. It's the only way it's going to be funded. So we may no longer have power to set rates, but understanding where the problems are and how much money it's going to cost to fix those problems informs what the rates ought to be. And I think that we need to help the mayor with that decision, to help this department give that information to the mayor. So I think it's
going through these guys rather than going to the mayor.
Yeah, we're not going to vote on. We're not going to set the rate, but we're going to make recommendations, and we want to support the department to do that.
Yeah,
and we have a history of having comments and thoughts in a timeline.
Sure.
You know, some of it was related to fiduciary responsibilities, but some of it related to philosophy in terms of things that we wanted to do.
How much money do we borrow and how much money do we save?
Mm-hmm. These are fun times as we just sit here trying to figure out what we're doing.
Swimming.
Yeah. So, you know, can we get some clarity in terms of the timeline and the process for the budget this year? Because we know how it happened last year.
We have a meeting next Wednesday with the mayor. From there, my understanding is that he will look at projects and make what projects he wants to make go forward will happen, and then we can set and look at the rates accordingly. Right now, we're looking at 0 to 5% rate increase, a 10%. We don't know right at the moment because he wants to select the projects, but he can't really select the projects without recommendations from us. And this is what we're trying to do, is get all this information to him so that he can see the expanse of work that needs to be done, particularly at the wastewater treatment plant and our collection system. There's a lot of work to be done. We can't avoid it.
Seems to me we have to let that process play out and see what the administration comes up with for projects and then comment on that.
You got it, because he's looking to somehow prioritize and help him prioritize by what staffing, put together some staffing priorities on the basis of a report that he's going to be getting, which should then help him consider whether positions are going to be needed to move certain projects along in an expeditious way, all of which has to be done by the time the budget is presented to the council, which is usually in May, because it starts in July. Wow, it's a lot.
Yeah. 6 weeks.
Okay.
Anything else on budget?
I have to excuse myself.
You have to be at the show tomorrow by 8 o'clock. So, anyone else have anything else here? Pat?
I was just wondering, are we going to see the roundabout on Pleasant Street and Conn's?
Yes.
In the
They're actually next getting ready to put it out to bid.
Excellent.
The construction?
Yeah.
Nice.
That trip to Boston you said you were taking the last time we met.
Yeah.
That worked out well with that Damon Road light, because that's much improved. Of course, it was terrible.
It's much better. It just took a few weeks after that meeting to finally
have
it all happen. Yeah. It's not better. It's not perfect, but
it's much better.
So this is the traffic signal at the railroad crossing?
It's actually the one at the industrial park. The complaints have diminished substantially.
So why do you have to go all the way to Boston to get that addressed? I mean, what the hell? I mean, there's a district office right up here. There's somebody in charge.
We travel with District 2 to Boston for this meeting.
It seems odd to me.
So they had to go up.
They had to go to Boston for the meeting, and we joined them for support.
And they just had to adjust the cycling?
Yeah.
Gary?
I have a follow-up question to Terry's question. So it's going out to bid. Will it be constructed this year? Or is that for next
year? Yes.
It will be constructed this year.
I'm not sure if they'll finish it completely this year, but that's
wow.
It's going to start this year.
And there's no third lane for turning right off of Conn's?
Excellent.
Okay.
And this is a DOT project, not a city project.
This is a DOT project. In fact, the engineering was paid by Mass DOT. Mm-hmm. One of the agreements that the Mayor Higgins had is that the state wants to discontinue that layout from basically Hoyoke Street out to the dike. And one of the goals was fix this high accident intersection for us, and we'll do that.
But there is city participation because we're replacing the water line from Conn Street through the dike, which is part of the asset management priority.
Is that going to result in parking along the lower end of Pleasant Street there?
It will open that up. Huh? It'll be no longer state highway.
Do you have anything else there?
That was it. Thank you.
Jim? How about, did we have the Tate and Howard presentation? We did that.
Good point. You know, I never scheduled them. There were just so many maddening emails, to be honest with you. I don't know. I think maybe what I'll do is I'll send out a doodle poll to everybody, and I'll pick about 18 meetings, and then everybody can tell me which ones work. And then when everyone's available, I'll have them come.
So it's not on the 22nd?
No, because it was just, I can't make it, I think it's important, I want to be there, but I want to be here. It's just like...
So you think that's going to change going forward?
I'm hoping. I'm hoping if I send out a poll, I can have people fill it out, and then when I can get a consensus of everyone's availability, I'll have Don Tate come in and do it.
Okay.
So anyway, I apologize. I should have got back and let everybody know, but I'm glad you raised the issue. They're willing to come, but it would be a good thing for everyone to see, which is why I was hesitant to schedule it.
Sure.
With the conflict, so. But, yeah. No.
DJ?
I'm good.
David?
I'm all set.
Hello?
I'm fine.
Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
We are adjourned.